Okay. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here today. I'm so excited to have you on and for this conversation. I guess we'll start with our first question, which is like a four-part question. But okay. It is, what is your name? What are your pronouns?
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
No, go for it. We'll start with those two.
Okay. My name is Suzen Baraka, and my pronouns are she and her.
Mm-hmm. What is your ethnicity, and who are you?
My ethnicity is I'm half Black, half Korean, even though that's sort of a misnomer. I'm Black and Korean, and who am I? I am an actor. I am a writer. I'm a producer by necessity, and I used to practice law. I am still licensed to practice law, but I just try not to practice it if I can avoid it.
Trying not to be a lawyer if you can avoid it. I'm fascinated to hear about that. We're definitely going to have to get into that because I have many questions, and that's amazing. But yeah, so I was reading up on you from your website, and you've been performing for almost 2 decades at this point. I'm wondering how you got your start. What sort of brought you into, I guess, the craft of acting, and what sort of sparked your interest in the art form starting out?
Well, I've been performing in the sense that I've been writing and performing spoken word for the last two decades. I started in high school. I started slamming my best friend in high school. Her name is Charisse Bollier. Bollier Blue now. She like moved to my town from Pennsylvania and introduced me to slam poetry. And that sort of changed my life because I was already writing poetry, but it wasn't like anything great. And then when she introduced me to that sort of opened my world up, and I was like just drawn to it. And then I started slamming and doing all the things at the New Eurekan Poets Cafe, Serengeti Plains in New Jersey, and just sort of getting into that world. And then that sort of connected me with one of my mentors, Angela Kariotis, who is a brilliant performance artist, and she introduced me to speech forensics. And at the time, I was already in college at that point, and didn't know anything about speech forensics. Just always thought speech and debate is like what you kind of see in the movies and on television, and didn't realize there was this whole performance aspect to it, and sort of got involved in that way. And then graduated college and felt like, okay, do I go? I had actually wanted to go to acting school. I mean, go to college for acting, but I like chickened out because I just never saw anybody who did that, and I didn't see anybody. It just wasn't. It didn't seem like a reality for me.
Same.
So I was an English major and an Africana Diaspora Studies major, and writing always felt more tangible. So I was actually considering going to get my MFA in creative writing, but my mom was like, no, you're going to go to law school. So, and at the same time, I had ended up getting a job at Skadden Arps, which is like one of the top 5 law firms in the world.
Damn.
As a legal assistant. And so I spent some time there, and then the 2008 crisis hit, and they needed people to go because the firm had lost a lot of its clients as a result of that crisis. And so they gave me a package deal. And it was like perfect timing because I was going to go to law school anyway. Ended up going to Cardozo Law School. And then I would practice law I started out in music entertainment law because I felt like, well, at least it's like entertainment adjacent. And I did a little bit of television and film law too. My specialty in law school was independent film. And then I realized there wasn't a ton of money in entertainment law on the artist side. So I randomly got wrapped up in investment banking somehow, just like a random phone call. And I was like, hey, do you want to come work at this bank and do a temp job? And I was like, sure. And then I was doing the temp job, and my boss at the time was like, you're a little too smart for the job. And I was like, I know, I'm licensed to practice law in 2 states. Like, and at the time, I think I was like, you know, just doing like really basic work, but I kept pointing out issues with like substantive things. And so they brought me on full time as assistant vice president for recovering and resolution planning for the Americas team. And I did that for and was promoted a few times. And then after 5 years, I knew I wanted to go to acting school. So I started looking at acting schools, sort of secretly. And then I told myself, Suzen, by August 2018, you're gonna quit this job and you're gonna go to acting school. And then August 2018 rolled around and I was like, maybe not. Maybe you're just moving too fast. Maybe you need to take it slower. And then I ended up being let go from that job. Okay. And I was like, oh, okay, maybe I should go to acting school. And then a month later, I started applying again. And then a month later, I was actually offered a job at Warner Brother Records here in LA. And 15 days before my start date, my boss or my soon-to-be boss had a change of heart. And I was like, what the heck? I was about to move from New York to LA to take this job. And this was me taking the safe route. Like, I was going to take acting classes in LA, like, and just have my safety job of being a music lawyer. And I was like, if it's not even going to be safe, I might as well just go do the thing I actually love. And so I had already been accepted into the Atlantic Theater Company Conservatory at the time. I had already received a partial scholarship. And I remember I turned them down because I was like, I'm going to go to Warner Brothers and I'm going to do music law and I'm going to just take acting classes in LA. So I turned them down already. And as soon as that happened, I called Chris Booth back up and I said, is there any chance that I can come back? And he was like, you know, Suzen, I actually never processed your rejection because I was hoping you would change your mind. And so my scholarship and my acceptance. And
you're like, can I still get that money?
Exactly. So still available to me. So shout out to Chris Booth.
Shout out to Chris Booth.
Amazing. And shout out to Sam and Tom because they were the ones who Sam Gonzalez and Tom Costello because they were the ones who auditioned me. And they saw something in me that I don't even think I saw in me at that time. And so I ended up going to the Atlantic Theater Company Conservatory full time, and that was very intentional because I was like, as many times as I flip flopped on this, if I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna like put my everything into it, and it's gonna be my only focus, and it's just what I'm gonna do. And of course, I still needed like survivor money, right? So I like took on little odd jobs, but like during that time, and it was really challenging, but. Yeah. But yeah, from that point on, it was official. I was an actor.
Wow. That's an amazing story.
Yeah. And that was 2019. I started at the Atlantic. So from 2019 to now. Yeah.
Yeah. So you're in the pandemic group as well. So that must've been, obviously a wrench in a curveball thrown at you.
Oh yeah. Like we were in school for, I want to say like one semester and then a quarter of a semester before we were then told, hey, we're going to give you guys, we're going to let you guys go home like super early. Cause I think we hadn't even gotten to spring break at that point yet. And it hadn't been officially declared, but the school was being like extra cautious because there is so much interaction in class that they were like, we just can't take that chance. We can't take that risk. So the pandemic hadn't even been declared when we were all sent home. And then I learned how to act via Zoom for the next 2 years. So that was fun.
And being like, we hope you have a big enough room in your apartment that you can do movement classes in your little space. Like, better buy a nice camera and a background because we're going to see all your business. So let me ask you, like, when you were in college, I guess even before that, and when you were, lawyering and being a lawyer in law school, were you acting at all? Or was this just something that this was just sort of like the seed had been planted somehow that you had an aptitude for and that you could do it?
I had been doing, like I said, I've been doing spoken word. So I'd been touring and doing different iterations of spoken word performances.
Which is acting, yeah.
Which is acting. So I was doing a tour called Her Story for like, I've been doing it for over 10 years now, actually. Shout out to Her Story and KO Charles. deaf poet, brilliant deaf poet. At some point, so my best friend who lives in DC and teaches at Howard University, she is also a television and film director. And her name is Jami Rambaran, and she's like my partner in crime as well. And she wanted to do a short film. So I ended up doing that short film with her in, I want to say it was mid-2018. So it was around the time that I was like secretly looking at transitioning out of law. Mm. And so I did that short film because I think she knew and I knew that like this was something I always wanted to do and something I sort of had like a knack and inclination for. So I did that short film. And even though like now I look back at the acting in that short film and I'm like, oh my God, I learned so much in acting school. But like in fairness, even though it was during a pandemic, but we won the Cannes Viewer's Choice Award and with that short film and got into a number of festivals and did really, really well. I think it was like little things like that that sort of kept acting relevant for me. Yeah. Was like making my own projects, making projects with my friends and family. My sister Ayana Baraka is also a DP, a brilliant DP, and you know, like I was helping her work on her Greenwood Avenue series. It's a virtual reality series. She actually specializes in virtual reality cinematography. So like helping her with that. I'm not acting in it, but I was helping with the writing process. And like right. little things like that sort of kept me always sort of in the loop and in the artistic world. But I wouldn't necessarily say that I was like acting until I got to acting school.
Right. Yeah. Right. And then yeah. definitely realized that the aptitude was there. The talent was there. I can do this, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. I want to ask you also about spoken word poetry is what we're calling it. Cause I don't know. I mean, I've obviously seen it, I guess on YouTube, but I'm not very well versed in it. But I mean, it seems to me, if I'm mistaken, that it's, you know, it's performing a monologue. It's Shakespeare. There's a lot of the math, I guess, is very similar. What has that done for you in terms of like developing yourself as just an artistic instrument through the entire process, the writing, the rehearsal, the performance? What has it done for you? What have you taken from it, I guess?
Well, the fun thing about poetry is, and being a spoken word poet and a writer, mm-hmm. is that mm-hmm. you have like a facility and an understanding of language and rhythm that I think sometimes like people don't realize kind of factors into acting. Like I often think of acting as being something akin to music and sports, right? Yeah. Like there's definitely this athletic and in the moment aspect about acting that's very sports-like. And at the same time, there's also this like melodic, almost musical, rhythmic aspect of acting that's also really, really important. And I mean, if I'm being honest, I was also in Shakespeare Club in high school. So like, I've always loved Shakespeare and the classics and always loved like a lot of this like very lofty, big language and always been drawn to that. And I mean, in my opinion, that's probably my wheelhouse because of being able to write poetry, being able to perform poetry, having so much comfortability with spoken word, that yeah, like I feel like the classics are actually my wheelhouse. I just don't get an opportunity to do a lot of it because I just keep getting wrapped up in other things. But yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see how that would connect right to the classics, like bringing a text that is very inverse and bringing it to life and making it I guess understandable and approachable for an audience. Bringing it to life. That's awesome. Would love to see you perform that at some point. Do you have anything on like YouTube that we can see of you performing? I know that.
Oh, absolutely. So, yeah. In 2020, I'm like looking at it now. In 2020, I was very blessed to win an Emmy, a New York.
I was going
to
ask you about vote. Yes.
New York Emmy. This was I'm projecting because we're vying for New York Emmy now. I won a regional Emmy for Vote, which is a spoken word piece that I was commissioned to write by Poetic People Power. And I was asked to write a piece about the 2020 election. This was during the time of George Floyd. This was the time of Breonna Taylor. This was the time of Ahmaud Arbery, and also the rise in violence against Asian Americans, and also trying to get money for my mother's business, her Korean barbecue restaurant in New Jersey, and just trying to survive. And at the same time, knowing that like everything about my identity is currently under attack. And then having the job of telling people to go vote, which seemed like an impossible task. And I just kept asking different people. I would kept, you know, procrastinating and being like, how the heck am I supposed to write a poem about voting when all this stuff is going on? And then that ended up being the through line for the piece. So, so vote and my name will bring up the video, but it's available online. It's also available on my Instagram page. We also just finished the film festival circuit. I say finished, but we're actually waiting to hear back from Essence Film Festival. But we are touring with our latest piece called My Asian. Don't hate me, y'all. I'm not good at naming things. I just go to the easiest.
Hey, I get it. At the
distance with respect to naming. Yes. It is not my forte. But I wrote a piece called My Asian, which is basically, I was originally asked, there was a corporate client who wanted me to do a piece about the rise in violence against Asian Americans, being half Korean, like that really spoke to me. And so I agreed to do the show. And then as I started to write the piece, I was like, actually, this is bigger than this show. So I actually need to cancel this. And I need to really spend time writing this piece. And the piece took quite a while to write, maybe like a month or two. To write, and it took a lot out of me, and it really became sort of a labor of love. It's the longest piece I've ever written, but it's really honestly speaks a lot to a lot of the unearthed trauma that I experienced being Asian that I didn't realize I experienced being Asian. It's almost like I didn't know it was there until I started to dive in. I really love this piece. We shot a video for it, and we went to Urban World Film Festival with it. We went to the Michelle Film Festival and won Best Performance in an experimental short. We went to the Pan African Film Festival, the Mixed Media the Mixed Asian Media Film Festival. I'm forgetting the word.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that was a thing. That sounds right up my alley. Great.
Yeah. So we've been doing really, really well, really well with it. But I want to, honestly, I just want to release it to the world because I do think it's an important piece. Because I think a lot of people can probably identify with it, whether they're Asian or not, you know? So,
it sounds awesome, and congratulations on all the success that it's already had. Can you give us more of like a sneak peek into what is sort of what it's about, like what you're saying? Because you mentioned it was sort of obviously about your identity as a Korean person, but what else could we expect when we do see that?
When I wrote about it was meant to be about the rise in violence against Asian Americans. But when I started to write it, I began it with a story of when I was young, when I was 6 years old. We had a birthday party in the basement rec room of my apartment building in Newark, New Jersey. That's where I was born and spent some of my childhood years. Mm-hmm. And I remember we laid out these dumplings that my mother spent the night before, like hand making these dumplings. They were so beautiful. Mm-hmm. And dumplings were my favorite food as a kid.
Right.
And I remember that when the other kids saw the dumplings, because that was not what they thought of when they thought about like Asian food, right? Mm. Their reaction to it was so negative that I became embarrassed. And I didn't want to, and I was like, yeah, gross. And I like kind of like took on their opinions and was like, yeah, that's gross. Like, yeah, we're not going to eat this. And I ended up not eating the food that my mom has stayed up the whole night making. And I just remember being so, and I still get emotional about it. It's so stupid, but it's like, I just remember being so heartbroken because it was something I was so proud of, and nobody was open to it, and nobody understood. Yeah. And that same thing kept happening like over and over again, even into adulthood, where it's like little aspects of my culture and things that I love and like hold dear to me are so heavily rejected and criticized by American culture that it kind of makes you feel this shame about who you are and the things that you love. And whether it be food or the way that food smells, because you know that's a big thing in this country. Right. And it was a big thing in my corporate office. Because I would always order like Korean food or Indian food, and oh, there goes Suzen with her stinky lunch again, you know, just like little bullshit like that. And but then also like other things, the way that I know so many women, Asian women, you know, get the surgery on their eyelids, or the way that, you know, we're constantly trying to live up to these Eurocentric beauty standards, and it's just, it starts to make you feel shame and hatred towards the things that make your culture beautiful. And so that's really what the video for me was about. It was about demonstrating that, number one, I don't have shame anymore. I refuse to feel shame over my culture. My culture is beautiful. It is gorgeous. It is flavorful. It is rich. Mm-hmm. And it's also very much a part of this American fabric.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And thank you. No, thank you so much for sharing that. Yeah, it's interesting what you said earlier about, like, I guess, like, not realizing so many of these, as an Asian person, the racial traumas that we sort of go through collectively, I guess, until adulthood or ever. I think that's very much a part. And I think that's very much a part of the Asian experience. That's very much a part of the model minority experience. Is to, for us to really gaslight ourselves and think that everything is okay when things are really not okay. We're not a monolith. I can't speak for everyone, but yeah, I think that really resonates, with me, that statement that you're saying. I think that's really, and those are some powerful reflections to sort of think back on and be like, dang, like, nah, like that was fucked up. Yeah. And important conversations to sort of have.
Yeah.
So I guess moving into that, a lot of the work that you do, and you have said on, I guess, on your website that I was reading on, has to do with your intersectional identities as a Black woman and a Korean woman. Could you just talk about, I guess, how those identities sort of inform the work that you do, inform who you want to be as an artist, and et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, it's so interesting because I don't know that I really understood it, actually, probably until I started at Atlantic. And, you know, shout out to my classmates, because they are so good and so understanding. And I was really, really grateful to have, like, a great group of people around me who really tried to make me feel seen and heard and understood. But there's also this thing of the first couple years of acting school, it was like every scene that we did, that I did for the first couple years of acting school, I played a character that was written to be white and or male. Mm. And that's, sorry, my dryer is making a lot of noises.
like, no worries.
Okay, friend? But yeah, every character that I played was either white and or male. And I don't think that was out of like malintent or any of that. But I just think it was just what, it was like, these are the scenes that people are excited to play. These are the scenes that people are excited and want to share. And so a lot of times I would end up doing scenes that were, that's what they were meant for. They were meant to be played by white men. And then by the middle of the second year, I started to feel like I was going crazy, because I was like, I don't even know if I'm doing a good job, because I don't have no barometer for like what I'm doing. But very early on in the process, when I was playing these roles that were written for white men, I decided that I was going to play them as exactly who I am. Hmm. I am not a white man. So irrespective of who this is meant to be, I have to play that, or even white women, whatever, regardless, whatever. But I was like, whoever this was meant to be, that's not who's playing it. So I can't play it like I'm white. I can't play it like I'm a man. So how does the role being played by me as a Black Korean woman, how does that change the role? How does that, what does this set of circumstances mean for me? And my first role out of law school, I played an Air Force fighter pilot who gets grounded. So the title of the play is Grounded. It's by a playwright named George Brandt. We opened at the Denizen Theater in upstate New York, and incredible run, incredible theater company, and an incredible play. It was a one-woman show. It was a lot to memorize. It was probably the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. It is not a short show. Anne Hathaway opened it at the Public. And I was very fortunate to be able to take on this role because it's such a powerful character. But, like, what does it mean that it's being played by me? I remember before we even opened, the composition of the town is very white and very old. It skews older, even though it's like a college town. And I remember one of the local neighborhood folks, older white woman, came by to like check out like what's the new show that's coming out. And the flyer doesn't have my face on it. It doesn't have anybody's face on it. It's just like, it just shows like sort of the back of a fighter pilot, but you could tell that it's a woman. And so she was like, oh, what's this play about? And like we told her, it's like, yeah, it's about a female fighter pilot, F-16 fighter pilot who gets grounded after she gets pregnant and becomes a drone pilot and has to reconcile that with that life with being a mom and a wife. And she was like, what? A woman in the Air Force? That's not believable. And then she kind of just walked off. And I remember whoever I was, I can't remember if it was my stage manager or Sam, but I can't remember if it was Brian or Sam, but they looked at me and they were like, wait till they find out it's you. Like, wait till they show up and find out you're the one playing it.
Like if that was just tripping over, like, yeah, just wait till you see the show. Like you're gonna have your socks pulling off.
Yeah, wait till you find out she's Black and Asian.
Oh, woo! My God.
Lose her mind. So, you know, it was so funny. But it was, but it's that part too, right? It's that bringing the fact that like, what would it have taken for a Black presenting woman to make it that far high up in the chain of the Air Force? And how does that factor into the story? So I'm constantly thinking about that with every character that I approach. And I'm constantly making an effort not to negate any aspect of my identity when I'm taking a character on, if that's a part of the identity that can be brought into it, you know, based on the script, because also it's about serving the story. But I do believe in leading with specificity, and that means leading with like who I really am. I don't know if I answered your question, but
no, absolutely. No, 100%. And I'm also wondering, because you sort of made a reference to this earlier, I guess feeling a bit disoriented playing like characters that are made to be played by white men and white characters in general. Have you ever felt sort of like pressure or caught yourself, performing for a white audience like differently than you would want to? Has that sort of factored in at any point in terms of your acting? Both like when you're training in. Mm-hmm.
No, I get it. I 1,000% get it. But I think having done spoken word for so long, the one thing that I learned from spoken word that I carry with me into acting is as much as I want the audience to like get something out of this, and as much as I want to, and as much as I feel connected to the audience when I'm working, the end of the day, it's about the story. It's just about the story. I can't worry about what the audience is thinking and what and how they're receiving the information. All I can hope is that I'm doing the best job that I can do to serve the story. And right. that way, it number one, takes the pressure off of me to feel like I'm performing. And because if I'm too worried about performing, then like if I don't get the laugh when I think I'm gonna get the laugh, or if, you know, so there's theater, right? Like I do a lot of theater. If someone's falling asleep in the front row, it's like, well, but you know, that's like, it's theater, so it's inevitable. Yeah. Like the lights are off, you know.
It's people get happen. Sleepy during matinees. Yeah, I get it.
You know, so it's like, it just happens. But yeah, like I really try to focus on serving the story and the audience is just the beneficiary of what is, of the relationship I have with that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know if was it Meisner who said this himself, but it's like you can't. Somebody said this who was like a Meisner person, but they said, you know, you can only be yourself. You cannot try to be somebody else. The most interesting person that you can be on stage is yourself. Yes. And, you know, audiences will see through the artifice of you trying to be somebody or not. I think that's a hard lesson for a lot of actors. That's something that I've definitely been grappling with a lot lately, especially like transitioning now to film. For some reason, when the camera's on me, like I want to be an entirely different human being. And I feel just, it's really weird. I just feel like I can't even like be myself. When I'm on stage, I'll do anything, go anywhere, so much freedom. When the camera's on it, I'm just like, what am I? Like, I feel so weird about myself, but that's my thing. I need to deal with that. I'm sure I'm not the only one who has ever dealt with something like that.
No, you're not. My acting teacher was like, Suzen, why did your voice change when we hit record? And I'm like, I don't know.
Right? Yeah. Doing like this with your hands. I'm like, oh, hello. Like, slight British accent. What am I doing? Like, no. Yeah. That's what we're dealing with right now. That's what I'm dealing with right now. But anyways, talking about acting craft. Yeah, we'll get over that. Speaking of acting craft and speaking of your time at Atlantic, because it seems like you had a really interesting experience there, especially through the pandemic, having to be like so flexible in so many ways. But what did you gain from being a full-time conservatory student there? How did it prepare you for your work now and your work in the future?
You know, I think Atlantic is one of those places where, like, I was really allowed to, like, lean into professionalism and understanding the business in a way that has really truly served me. And I find that it was twofold, right? Like, you spend the first 1.5 years really focused on craft and process and, like, aspects of professionalism, like showing up early and, you know, those kinds of things. But then towards the latter half, and because we were in the pandemic, you know, and shout out to the teachers who, like, really, you know, showed up for us because, like, I mean, I just remember we were all struggling. It was a hard time. But like, I remember like Sam Gonzalez and Reggie White and Tom Costello and Anya. Oh my God, Anya. Just everybody, like truly, and Kelly, like everybody just showing up for us and just being present and making the most of a not so great situation. And even Donnie, like, giving us, like, video projects and just being creative about how to attack the problem of acting and listening over Zoom. Like, this could not have been – I know that it was hard for us as students, but this could not have been easy for the instructors either.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
No.
So shout out to them for being creative, for sticking it out, for dealing with our attitudes and our emotionality and, you know, and our panic and our anxiety. Like, God bless the teachers at Atlantic. Because, I mean, it was such a challenging time for everyone. And at the same time, like, I remember, like, because we were going through this unprecedented time, the teachers were really open about, like, answering our questions and trying to, like, give us time outside of class. Like, I remember so many times Francine Zerfus, like, would meet up with me after class, like via Zoom, and just like answer my questions and walk me through some of my vocal issues, which there are a million, and just be there for me and like listen to me and just be, oh, and to this day, like I still, like while I was doing Grounded, I still showed up for her vocal sessions whenever I could, because I mean, honestly, this is all part of the work, right? Is like staying consistent and developing a practice, and that's the thing I think going through the pandemic taught me, was like, no one's gonna make you do this work. You have to show up too, and you have to be committed, and you have to make this a regular part of your process. And you've got to want it more than the world is making it uncomfortable and unpalatable for you.
Wow. Yeah.
So I had a, I, you know, I'll say this. I had a great time at Atlantic, even via Zoom.
Damn.
And in addition to that, Atlantic made it worthwhile for me to show up during a time where I feel like most people wanted to crawl into bed. And so I am just super grateful to them. And then, like, you know, I learned a lot about, I probably learned more about self-tape from Katie Honiger. I learned so much about self-tape. Thanks to, oh my God, and Jessica, I learned so much from Jessica Fry about self-tape, that I still use today. It's been incredible. It's been incredible working with the teachers there, because they're real professionals. They're going through it too. They literally audition just like us, with us. Like comedy and lot, like last week we were talking about Lotsies, and I was like, in my acting class here, and I was like, I know all about Lotsies. Thank you, Andy. Like, this is great. So it's constantly, the work that I learned there is constantly coming up. So yeah, I'm super grateful for that experience.
Yeah, and I've been reflecting on like what has been the benefit of like learning to act over Zoom. And I don't know if I know yet, but I've been thinking about it. And I just think like I have all, you've been in the same situation when you're like you're in your room and you're trying to do a scene and you're just like, I feel so disoriented. I feel so disconnected. What am I doing here? Like, I need to look at somebody in the face. I want somebody to touch me to get connected or something. And you just have to find it. And it's just you just have to really, I think, commit 1,000,000%, even more than you would if you were in person. And I think there's something to be learned from that. Like, how am I gonna transmit this message and information to people who are looking on a screen when I'm in my room and, I'm staring at my K-pop posters in the face right now when I and it's throwing me off. Like, I don't, it's like just dealing with all those like weird variables. I don't know. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, but those are things I've thought of the last couple of years. So,
No, I mean, it's so interesting because I actually have a corner in my bedroom in Brooklyn that when I get in that corner, that's the corner. Like, magic is gonna happen. Acting magic is gonna happen. I do so many really great auditions in that corner because of my experience of, like, being at Atlantic and like having to find like little interesting and creative nooks and crannies of my place to like figure out, like, how do I make the scene pop? Like, how do I make the scene work? And at the same time, even, oh my God, what an experience trying to do Moment Lab with Carl via Zoom, my God.
Yo.
But the challenge of that, it was actually great because that curiosity, if you can have that type of curiosity via Zoom, you can have that type of curiosity in the world with no problem. Because it, let me try, it's a challenge. But when I'm out in the world, it's like now it's like, oh yeah, I try as much as possible to notice everything, feel everything. Cause like the thing with Zoom is like when you're trying to have a moment lab and you're like looking into a screen, it's like you realize how much you're missing. Yeah. You realize the texture, the smell, all of that. You realize how much you're missing. So when you do get out into the world and you do get in person and you do have access to that, then all of a sudden it's like the world becomes so much richer and so much more alive. And then you just like, oh, you just want to grab it all. So it was like, yeah, we could, I don't know. I really enjoyed you know, I really enjoyed my time. Suzen used to always say, you know, leave yourself alone and give yourself a brain break. Mm-hmm. And to this day, I am constantly using those two terms. Mm. Leave yourself alone and give yourself a brain break. And I think that whether we're on Zoom or whether we're in person, the truth of the matter is that we're enough. When she says leave yourself alone, it's like, to me, the equivalent is you are enough. You don't have to do anything to yourself. You don't gotta stand a certain way. You don't gotta do nothing extra. You are enough. And stop all that extra chatter in your head. Give yourself a brain break. All those extra voices don't need to be there. Be in them, just be. And so, like, yeah, I mean, I definitely get all that you're saying, but I also feel like, I don't know, it's also my birthday, so I'm also really introspective today.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. I chose this day intentionally for this conversation because.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yeah, people are always like, how are you celebrating your birthday? And I'm like, I celebrate by being in my purpose. So every year, like, I find ways to be working on my day of birth, because mm-hmm. this is how I want to every year day of the year to be. I want to be living in my purpose and working every day of the year. So I didn't know what today was going to be. 2 weeks ago, I had to like part ways with my LA team, my LA rep team. So my manager and my agent here, and I still have my New York agent. I mean, sorry, I still have my New York manager. But my New York manager, is very supportive of like my LA endeavors. And so, you know, 2 weeks ago I was a disaster, 'cause I was like, what am I going to do? You know, I'm really trying to figure this thing out. A few weeks ago when we were trying to set up this meeting, I was like, today is not the day to do this meeting. It's like the day will be my birthday. I don't know what my life is going to be like on my birthday, but I know that whatever it is, it'll be the right day. And it is, because I let go of my LA team on faith that it was the best thing to do. And we parted ways, and I was really nervous about what that would mean. And then I booked a play this week. And I have rehearsal tonight. And so it's like, yeah, I get to spend my birthday living in purpose, living my dream, literally. So, yeah, it's a blessing.
Can I just give you a round of applause real quick for that? That's amazing.
All right, that was such a tangent. I don't even know how I got there. But
that was wonderful. First of all, happy birthday. Like, thank you for sharing, like, this time with me on your birthday. That's amazing. Congratulations on the show. Can you tell us anything about it, or are we hush hush for now, or like, what's up?
I'll tell you, it's an amazing show. Mm-hmm. Honestly, it's really, really, really a brilliant show. It's written mm-hmm. by this playwright, named Francisca de Silveira. I hope I'm pronouncing their name right. And the play is brilliant. It really is just one of those plays. It's uproariously funny. It has so much heart. And so much meaning. It's about the trend of gentrification in Boston, and how it affects this black woman-owned beauty and hair supply store in the Roxbury section of Boston. Mm. And it's incredible. I play two characters, a black woman named Mika, who works at the hair supply store, and a white woman named Beth, who works, who's basically the figurehead for United Bank, who is trying to sort of redevelop this part of Boston. And I am incredibly excited for it. The director, Greg Daniel, is actually, he just directed Twilight for the Center Theater Group at the Mark Taper Forum. I went to go see it. It was incredible. I remember, and this was a couple weeks ago, this was like 3 weeks ago, I remember sitting in the audience watching this incredible play, Twilight, about the 1992 race riots written by Anna Dewar Smith. And I remember thinking, oh my God, I want to do this. I want to be in a play where I get to transform and morph into different characters with completely opposing views, and like in front of people's eyes. And I want to like make that kind of magic. Like I want to make this kind of magic. And then lo and behold, this past weekend, I get a call back for this play. I didn't know who the director was. I didn't, you know, and I was really nervous because again, pandemic actor here. So I was like, this is my first in-person callback. I haven't had any in-person auditions. I've only done self-tapes. So I was
terrifying,
like,
terrified.
So I was like, Suzen, don't sweep your head up. Like, don't like psych yourself out. Like, don't look up any, like, don't do anything that's going to like freak you out.
Yeah.
And I was like, and I said a prayer that morning. I was like, God, please let it just be good energy in the room with everybody involved. And I got there and I made friends with so many brilliant black actresses. And then I went in the room and I just had fun. And I made mistakes in the audition for sure. But I kept playing and I kept experimenting and going. And God is so great because I got the part. And then realized, holy shit, this is the same director who directed Twilight. And I just said that. And here I am getting to do exactly the thing I wanted to do 3 weeks ago, sitting in that audience. So it was such a full circle moment. It is such a full circle moment. I'm still in the moment. And I'm super excited. We opened May 6th. It's being produced by the Rogue Machine Theater. It is being staged at the Matrix Theater in West Hollywood. And we are doing a 6-week run starting on May 6th. So I'm super excited.
That is absolutely amazing. It's a crazy life that we're living. You know, it's just riding the waves. Absolutely riding the waves. The ups and downs. That is just a perfect... A perfect like encapsulation of what the actor experience is sort of like. And I want to ask you this too, because I think your story is so interesting because you come from this background of being a lawyer and probably having a very, secure career path moving forward. And you decide to forego that to live this life, which as we know, in so many different ways can be so volatile and so unpredictable. What advice would you give to somebody like yourself who is sort of in that place of like comfort, I guess you could say, but wanting to commit to taking the plunge, trying to become an artist, chase the dream? What advice would you give to that person? Because that can be a really scary place to be and a really difficult place to be.
No, it's definitely a scary place to be. I'm going to say this. When I first left lawyering, investment banking, and then really truly committed to deciding to be an actor. So this is like there, because remember, there was like a span of time where it was like, I'll be honest, it's all kind of a blur now, but I do remember not being able to eat every day. I didn't have enough money to eat every day because I didn't plan for it. Like I just didn't do enough in the way of planning for it. And then I lost my job. I didn't quit the way I had planned to quit because I was like, oh, I didn't save, you know. And I just purchased a house January 11, 2018. I just purchased my house. So I also separated from my husband because he was not supportive of me wanting to pursue acting. And so I lost more than half of my income with losing my husband and also lost my husband, which was like not great or fun, and then lost my job. So then I lost all my income. I did not have a buffer because I had just purchased a house. So that was like all my savings plus renovations and like just a lot of things that go wrong that you don't realize will go wrong when you buy a house that was built in 1901. And so, like, I'm in this precarious situation. So, yeah, I lost my job, what, August 2018? And then the pandemic hit March 2020. All right, mm-hmm. So from August 2018 to March 2020, it's like this span of time where, like, everything's kind of up in the air. I thought I was going to go work at Warner Brothers, then I didn't. And then it was like, okay, well, what do I do? Right. What do I do? I don't have any money coming in. What do I do? And I, like, defaulted to being a teaching artist, and I wasn't making enough money. I was literally, and let me tell you something, there's nothing that humbles you more than going from living in the lap of luxury, and when the stories I could tell, but like living like a really, really, really privileged life, and then having to beg people for a swipe to get on the train, to get on the subway, or having to jump the turnstile, or having, you know, or not being able to eat every single day, which I was not eating every day. I lost 12 pounds in like the first couple months, which is very hard for me to do because for some reason my body's like losing weight. So that's like big. And then, and yeah, like I was really struggling. It was definitely one of the hardest points of my life. And I also think that, and it was almost like the feeling of like everything that could go wrong did go wrong. And I was really, it was just really hard. And so it's hard for me to advocate for anyone to put themselves through that. But I will say that once you commit, once the universe believes that you're committed, that it is my experience that if you're listening, you'll be able to know which direction you should go. And the truth of the matter is that I spent most of my life ignoring my talents and ignoring my blessings and ignoring what God wanted me to do because I was following other people's blueprints for their success. So, like, I had seen people in my life be successful in law, be successful in, you know, just in finance, be successful in all these other industries. But the truth of the matter is that that's not my gift. My gift is, and I had always treated poetry and spoken word and performing as, like, a hobby. Always. Even when I was touring, even when I was doing great, even when I was backstage of Deaf Poetry Jam, I was always like, I'm gonna be a lawyer, like, whatever. This isn't like my real job, you know? And that was so stupid because the moment that I listened to the universe and I listened to God and I followed my gifts and I followed my talent, literally the moment, like won an Emmy. I was getting booked for co-stars before I even got out of acting school. Like I was repped almost my entire time in acting school because this is my gift. Like, this is the thing I love. Like, I used to laugh at people in law school when they would be in the hallways, like, arguing about constitutional law. And I used to be like, fucking nerds. And now I'm the geeking out about playwrights like Martina Mayoke and Lee Edward Colston and now Francisca, because I'm like, oh my God, these playwrights are so good. Like, I am that nerd. Like, I'm that person that I used to laugh at because I finally found my version of that. And my version of that is this. Like, I was in denial for so long. And as soon as I started listening to the universe was like, oh, okay, you ready to accept your gifts and your blessings? Cool. We'll figure out a way to make it all work and give you your things. So I feel like this is that. So I just think, I don't know. I just think, listen, I think the only advice I can give is, like, just listen and listen to the universe and ask questions. Listen to your heart, listen to your gut, listen to yourself. Every time I don't listen to my gut, I regret it.
Yeah.
I've been saying that a lot lately. Every time I don't listen to my gut lately, I regret it. Even now, even after everything I've been through, I still find ways to betray myself.
Yeah.
And my instincts. And every time I do that, I fucking regret it. So I'm making an effort now. I'm making an effort every day to just like be honest with myself. So I think that's it. Be honest with yourself. That's my advice.
Yeah. And no, it's crazy how you think even, I guess, like logically that you made a great decision, but your gut feels bad about it. Or the opposite. Or you're like, logically, you're like, that was a crazy decision that I made. But you feel somehow at peace about it. And then you find, like, 6 months' time, a year, month's time, things kind of just work out. You didn't know why that decision wasn't for you or whatever, but it just somehow works out. I can really relate to that big time.
Yeah. And I had friends for years would be like, Suzen, you should be an actress. Suzen, you should be an actress. Suzen, you need to be an actress. And I would just be like, now I'm gonna be a lawyer. I'm gonna be a lawyer. And then when I finally decided to quit law, I remember I had one friend who's like, God bless her, because this is her personality. She actually sent me birthday breakfast today, birthday lunch. Mm-hmm. But I had one friend who, like, this is so outside of her like wheelhouse. So when I switched, she was like, I don't know what you're doing. She was like, there's no blueprint for success for acting. Like, I don't know. This is crazy to me.
Yeah.
And I don't know that I can support you in this because I don't understand it. Like, I just don't understand it. And I was like, I get it. I get it. It sounds crazy. It sounds fucking nuts. And for years when I was failing downward and and not eating and barely surviving and move back into my mom's house in my mid-30s. Yeah, I'm sure it did look crazy to a lot of people. But I just knew, and I still know. And even now, it's all hanging by a thread. Even now, it's all hanging by a thread. But I believe.
Yeah.
And I'm happy. I'm happier than I've ever been, so.
Yeah. And you're booking.
I'm booking.
Yeah. Where do you envision, if this is even possible, envisioning where your career could go from here? Where do you hope it can go? What's the kind of work that you want to continue to do in the future?
I'm still getting good at, like, or not getting good, but I'm still still learning what I'm built for and what I'm, and still trying to figure out, like, who I am as an actor. Because, like, again, this is all new. Like, I've only been out of school for a year and a month. Or maybe, I guess, a year and 2 months now. So I'm like, I don't even know who I am as an actor yet. I'm still trying to figure that out. So, I mean, honestly, the goal for me is just to be able to, like, pay my bills on time. And all of them, not just, like, one here and there. The goal is to be able to pay all my bills on time. And by doing this work consistently, I am right now figuring out how to work on more voiceover stuff, things that don't necessarily require my physical body to be in a room or on a location. So I'm trying to figure that world out now. And I'm also, you know, I'm still auditioning, but I'm also still writing. Like, I just finished another screenplay for a pilot. I have a couple like pilots written that I am pitching and sharing with friends and family and people that I love and getting their input on. So for me, it's just about being able to like live fully in my creative brain. So like I said, not having to practice law. Ooh, I'm getting a phone call.
That's okay.
All right. It's my birthday. People are calling. Yeah. and messaging. I know a couple of alarms went off. But it's about living and being in this creative space in my creative brain without having to, like, revert back to, like, my legal brain or my analytical brain and having to focus on those things right now. I really, really, really just want to be able to focus on my creative brain. So whether that be writing or acting, that's where I want to live.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I'm really trying to finish my spoken word album so I can submit for a Grammy.
Grammy this time. Yes.
Grammy this time. That's the goal. That's the goal.
I love that. That's amazing. I'm just, first of all, congratulations on your new show. It's going to be great. I can't wait for this album to come out. This is news to me, but can't wait for that. Big fan of yours. How do we get in touch with you on social media, website, et cetera, et cetera?
So my website is www.SuzenBaraka.com. And then my Instagram, which is probably preferable, is at Suzen, S-U-Z-E-N, underscore Baraka, B-A-R-A-K-A. Yeah, and that's pretty much, I don't use like Twitter or Facebook really, but hit me up on Insta. Check out my website if you're so inclined. And yeah,